Dear students, now we will start module 5. So the module 5 comprises of two portions, one on the reaction turbines, second one is on the centrifugal pump now. So here this module, now we will start with the reaction turbine, and in reaction turbine we will be dealing with the Francis turbine and the Keplon turbine now. So in this class we will be dealing with the Francis turbine description, working proportion and design. So as I told you, module 5, now this module 5 syllabus is being highlighted here now. So it is on reaction turbine and pumps now. So under that, Francis turbine is there, the description, working proportion, design and numerical problems. Keplon turbine is there, description, working proportion, design and numerical problem, and the draft tube which is provided for the turbine will be also be dealt now. Centrifugal pumps in detail it is there now. We will look into it in the later classes now. So we will now look into the Francis turbine. In this class we will look into Francis turbine description and working proportions and the design factor. In the next class we will go for the numerical problems. So the outcome of this one is you will be understanding the working principle of reaction turbine and the design of the Francis field turbine now, design features of the Francis turbine. So this we have already discussed in the classification of the turbine, what is a reaction turbine. Just to recapitulate what we have told in the module 4. So that once again I am doing for 5 minutes we shall spend on it, then we will go to the Francis turbine now. So as you know already, the reaction turbine are best suited for high flow rate. It is required for higher flow rate and low head situation. When you are having high head you require low flow now. High head availability is there now, low flow or low discharge is required, and the type of turbine is impulse. That's what we discussed in module 4, that is the Keplon turbine now. When we are having low flow, that means whenever we are having low head, when low head is available, then we have to go for low head, or you are having medium head, the only answer is the reaction turbine. Where you require large quantity of water. So reaction turbine works under medium head, best suited for medium head, and it requires a large quantity of water. That you should know it now. Now the next thing is, so here in the impulse turbine, as you know, the impact of the jet onto the vane is responsible for the conversion of the energy from the pressure energy in the potential energy is converted into kinetic energy before it is hitting to the jet. All the jet before it is hitting to the bucket, all the jet when the water is being coming out as a jet, it will become a kinetic energy now. The velocity increases enormously and it will hit to the bucket now. But here in the reaction turbine, the main problem here is the water that is entering into turbine will have both pressure energy and kinetic energy will be there. That is important now. So now, therefore, this is called as the reaction turbine now. So reaction turbine comprises of both pressure energy and kinetic energy. So in this, turbine. The best examples for this are the Francis turbine and Kaplan turbine, what you read it now. So the reaction in the case of impulse turbine, what you have seen is here the jet will be impinging on the bucket. Now all the energy is being converted into velocity energy, that is V squared by 2g. But in this, there is no jet. Jet formation is not going to happen. For that purpose, rows of blades are there. They are called as the stationary blades will be there now. As we discussed, the stationary blades will be there now. There are two types of blades will be there here now. One is the stationary blade and the one is the moving blade. Or it is also called the fixed blade and the moving blade now. From when the water enters through the fixed blade, or it is also called as the guide blade now. Here, the pressure energy is going to be get reduced and the velocity energy is going to be improved, or it is going to increase now. And when it changes the direction and hits to the moving blade, because of a torque is going to be developed now, because it is there on the wheel, as you can see here, it is on the wheel, these are called as the stationary blades now. These are called as the stationary blades or guide vanes. There the water enters spirally now and it enters into the runner. It is so designed like this, it is designed, and it will hit to the moving blade and it starts rotating now. The runner will start rotating. That is the principle here now. So as it moves towards the center, all the pressure energy will be converted into kinetic energy and the rotation is going to happen. The pressure goes on reducing from the outer periphery to inner periphery in this Francis turbine now. So here, that's what we have discussed now. The blades are this, when it is entering from here, when it is entering from the guide vanes, this will act as a jet now. The water that is coming out will act as a jet and it will impinge on the bucket now. This will form as a jet and it will impinge on the bucket. That will create the rotation. That will create the rotation of the runner. These are called the runner blades will rotate now. And the runner blade is being connected to shaft and the shaft will also rotate. Shaft is connected to the generator and the electrical energy is going to be generated now. So the fixed blades in this turbine acts as nozzle, as there is no typical nozzle as we see in the impulse turbine now. The blades are projected radially, that means along the radius it will be there. They are called as the stator. Stator means they are static blades. They are guide vanes only now. Okay. They are so shaped and mounted such a manner that space between the blades are formed just like the shape of the nozzle. They look like a nozzle now. When it passes through this, it will act as a jet now. It will act as jet and the rotation, it will hit to the runner plates and the rotation is going to take place now. As you can see here now in this picture now, it is hitting from here now and the rotation is going to happen in this direction now. That is the importance of reaction turbine now. Okay, the moving blades move as a result of the impulse of water. Once again, it is impact only of the jet received. In other words, they act at the nozzle now. The water enters through the whole circumference, that is important now. The water enters through the whole circumference. As you can see here now, completely the whole circumference, the water is entering now. Now here, importance here is the velocity is, the discharge is going to be get reduced as the water enters through this guide vane, and the velocity is maintained. When the discharge reduces, what will happen? The velocity has to be constant now. For that purpose, the cross section of this is being made spiral now. The cross section of this one is being reduced in order that the velocity is maintained constant. V is constant here now throughout. So like that we have designed. This is a spiral casing will be there. So water enters from the stay veins or the guide veins to the runner veins now. Okay. That is how the things takes place in the reaction turbine now. So the pressure drop gives rise to reaction in the opposite direction. That is what I told you. The pressure will start decreasing as it moves from the periphery towards the center. The pressure will start decreasing. Pressure will decrease. The velocity will increase. That's what that is how the reaction turbine will work now. So here there are two types of this one. This is a radial flow turbine. Radial flow turbines, all reaction turbine radial flow or mixed flow turbines now. So radial their input and axial output. This is what is this Francis turbine what we are going to discuss today now. If the water enters from outward, this what is radial flow, we know it now. If the water enters from outward, that is from the periphery it is coming, and it goes into it, it may flow in this direction or it may go out also like this now. This is called as the radial flow turbine. If it comes from outside, that means from the outer periphery, what you are seeing in this picture, it is inward flow because the water enters from here. It is called as the inward flow turbine now. It is inward flow, inward radial flow, because it is flowing radially. It is called as the radial flow first, and it is flowing in the radial direction. That means it is moving towards the radius, therefore it is called as radial flow. Radial inward flow turbine. This one now. Next, why it is called mixed? Let us look into it now. This is radial inward flow because the water enters from inside towards the axis. In some cases, it may flow from axis towards the outside. Then it is called as outward flow radial turbine now. So if the water flows from outwards towards inwards through the runner, it is called as inward flow radial turbine. If the water flow from inward towards outwards, it is called as the outward flow radial turbine now. So now, this is all discussed in the previous class now. So this also we have told, to some extent we have already told now. What is a Francis turbine? Francis turbine is a radial flow mixed turbine. Why it is mixed, we will look into it now. It is a radial flow turbine. It is moving towards the center now. It was designed first by a scientist known as James Francis. Name of the originator is James Francis. In his name only, the turbine is being named. The Francis turbine is a reaction turbine because the water entry is having both pressure energy as well as kinetic energy. Both pressure energy and kinetic energy will be there. It is not an impulse turbine. So here the feature is major pressure drop happens because of the flow into the turbine now. Pressure drop happens flow into the turbine now. Whereas pressure drop in the impulse turbine will completely take place before entering or before hitting the bucket. All the velocity, all the energy is converted into velocity energy. Whereas in the case of reaction turbine, partly you will be having potential energy as well as pressure energy as well as the kinetic energy now. So when the pressure energy is going to be get reduced, it reduces both inside the turbine as well as when it is flowing in the turbine also. So turbine passage always completely filled up with water in the case of the turbine, Francis turbine now. In this type of turbine, inlet is in the form of both pressure energy and kinetic energy, what I told you now. As the water flows, the part of the pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy. So that means in the turbine only, the pressure energy is converted into kinetic energy. That's what we have to see. That was not the case in the case of impulse turbine now. It is used for medium head to low head. medium head medium flow turbine now. Okay, so it is radial inward turbine, axially outward turbine, therefore it is called as mixed flow turbine now. Radially inward, axially outward, that means the flow is going outward at the axis only. How it is, we will look into it when we go ahead. We will be looking into it now. So here the water it contains, we will go for the this one now, design of the Francis turbine now. Francis turbine consists of a circular plate, as you can see here now. It is a circular plate on which these vanes, the runner vanes are present now. Just look into it now. Circular plate has curved channel on it. That is important now. It is a monolithic one. Curved channels are there on the circular plate itself now. These are called as the runner vanes. So on this circular plate only it will be there. At the end, at the center, you will be having a hole from where the water will go out now. The water enters from here now and water will flow down at this point now. So it is a circular plate. Francis turbine runner is a circular plate on which the runner, on which it is curved channels will be there now. Okay. The runner is encircled by a ring. Runner is encircled by the stationary channel called as guide vanes. These are called as the guide vanes now. Okay. These are guide vanes. Guide vanes are surrounded by stationary vanes. It is on a spiral casing. Completely it is on a spiral casing. I will be showing the picture in the next slide now. Okay. So now the runner is encircled by a ring of stationary channels called as the guide vanes. As the name itself indicates, what is the purpose of guide? To divert the water to the runner. That we will look into it in the next, when we are talking about the component, I will tell you in the next slide now. Guide vanes are housed on a spiral casing now. You can see here now, this is the runner vane now. These are called as the wicket gates, or it is also called as the guide vanes now. These are called as the guide vanes. And this is called as the stay vanes. So three circles are there now. This is also there in the spiral casing. This is also there in the spiral casing. The exit of the Francis turbine is at the center of the runner plate. What I showed you here now. This is the exit part. The water enters here and goes perpendicular to my slide now. This is the exit. So as you can see in this picture also, the exit is at this point now. The water enters from this point and goes to the spiral casing and passes through the stay vanes, then the guide vanes, then the runner, and it flows like this now. Here there will be a draft tube now. Therefore only it is called as a radial flow. It is moving towards the center, radial flow, radial input and axial output. It is moving, it is flowing down in the downward direction. This is the axis now. This is the axis. Along the axis the water is moving. Therefore it is called as axial output. The flow is in the axial flow. Axial output, radial input now. Radial input and axial output turbine now. Okay. It is a radial output and axial output. Radial input, very important. Radial inflow axial outflow. Therefore, it is called as mixed flow turbine. Mixed flow turbine. Okay. So now, there is a draft tube attached to the center of the exit now. What is the purpose of draft tube? We will look into it now. This is the draft tube. You can see here now. This is the draft tube now. What is draft tube? We shall look into it. Now, here you can see here now, the flow is in this direction. How the flow is happening now? Flow is happening as you can see here in this picture. It flows along the circumference. Here there is a stay vane. Stay vane is there now. And the guide vanes will be there. These are the guide vanes now. Guide vanes. And it is entering to the runner now. Stay vane, guide vanes, then the runner now. What is the purpose of stay vane? To divert the water without swirl into the guide vanes. What is the purpose of guide vanes? Effectively reduce the pressure and see that eddies doesn't create when it is entering into the runner, and the pressure is being get reduced in the guide vane as well as towards the center. That is the purpose of the guide vane now. Okay, so let us see it now. So now the draft tube is attached at the central exit runner now. So design parameters such as the radius of the runner, curvature of the channel, angle of vanes and size of turbine all depends upon the how much available head is there, what is the amount of power you want to generate now. So here, this is also a picture. As you can see here now, the diameter of the spiral casing is going on reducing now. The purpose of reduction of this diameter reduction means here, if Q is the discharge here now, the Q goes on reducing now. Q will become Q1, where Q1 is less than Q. And it will become Q2 at this point. Q2 is less than Q1. That means the discharge goes on reducing. As the discharge goes on reducing, the velocity is to be made constant now. The velocity in the spiral casing, velocity in the spiral casing shall be constant. For that purpose, the spiral casing is being reduced, diameter will be there now. So that we will tell you now. That's what. So now the first one is the penstock. As you can see, the components are, what is the penstock? As you know already, penstock brings the water from the reservoir to the turbine. It is a pipe carries the water from the reservoir to the turbine. That is what the purpose of the penstock now. So more about it we have already discussed now. What is the purpose of spiral casing? It is a closed passage whose cross section area is gradually decreases along the flow direction. It ensures that velocity of water is constant along its path. That's what I told you now. So it is a closed chamber, as you can see here in this picture also. Closed chamber, as you can see here in this picture also, it is a closed chamber. It is a cut section. It is a closed chamber now. It is a closed chamber so that the water enters from the penstock. Water enters from the penstock and it leads to the draft tube at the exit. After it passes through the stay vane, after it passes through the guide vane and the runner. Okay. Now, the next thing is, so as you can see here, this is also a picture where the, this is a big picture. This is called as a Cooley Dam, where the, how the spiral casing is being there. You can see here the diameter of this one is reduced very drastically here, very drastically. This is the Pelton wheel. This is the exit now. This is the point where the water flows to the tail race. Water flows to the tail race now. And this is the housing of all the runners as well as the stationary vanes and the guide vanes now. So I have already told you what is stationary vanes now, or stay vanes. It is also called as stay vanes. Stay vanes and guide vanes guides the water to the runner. Both the things are there now, stay vanes and guide vanes now. But stay vanes remains stationary. That is important. Stay vanes remains stationary at their position and reduces swirling. The swirling velocity is being reduced. That is by the purpose of the stay vanes. Water due to the radial flow now. Because the water is flowing through radial flow now, the swirling velocity is to be reduced. That is being utilized, that is being done by the stay vanes as it enters into the runner plates, thus making the turbine more efficient. So you have seen here the stay vanes. These are the stay vanes now. These are called as the stay vanes now. Okay, steering they have written, or stay vane. The same thing here also it is there. You can see here. This is the stay vane now. So how many stay vanes are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Like so many stay vanes are there. They will divert the water to the runner. They will divert the water to the runner now. They will divert the water to the runner proper now. Important. Okay. So now. So the purpose of stay vanes is to divert the water to the runner more efficiently and see that the swirling is being made reduced now. But they are stationary. They are stationary. Very important. They are stationary. Therefore only they are called as the stay vanes now. Now the next one is, you can also see here in this space, stay vanes and guide vanes now. These are called as the stay vanes. You can see here, these are called as the stay vanes. These are called as the stay vanes. Stay vanes directly towards the guide vanes now. Now, what is the purpose of guide vanes now? I have already shown you the guide vanes also here. The purpose of guide vanes, they are aerofoil shaped vanes now, arranged inside the casing. Important is they are arranged inside the casing to form a number of flow passages between the casing and the runner blade. So that means here you can see here these are called as the guide vanes. Guide vanes. These are runners. This is only guide vanes. It guides the water to the runner. It guides the water to the runner. The purpose of guide vane is to guide the water and reduce the eddies more efficiently. Decrease the pressure, increase the velocity energy. Decrease the pressure and increase the velocity. That means it still increases the velocity as it flows towards the center of the runner. Very efficiently hit to the runner for the rotation. That is what the purpose of the guide vanes now. But guide vanes are moving now. The purpose of the guide vanes can move and control the discharge to the runner now. Control the discharge to the runner. That is important of the guide vanes now. So, number of flow passages are there between the casing and the runner blades now. These vanes direct the water onto the runner at an angle appropriate to the design. These vanes direct the water to the runner at an angle appropriate to the design. Now that is very important. At what angle it should hit to the runner is being properly derived by the guide's position, guide vanes position now. Guide vanes only swing around their own axis. That is important. I will show you the picture here now. You can see here now. The guide vanes can swirl now. The guide vanes can swirl now. It can rotate it about its axis now. These are the axis about which it can move. It can move now. Okay. So, The configuration and arrangement of the guide vanes is such that the energy of water is consumed, not consumed by eddies. That means eddies, the loss of energy because of the eddies generated is being minimized by the guide vanes. That is important now. Okay, because the water is flowing from the periphery through the stationary vanes, eddies are going to be generated. The loss of energy is going to take place now. So this is being minimized by means of the guide vanes. Okay. So how the guide vanes operate now? Guide vanes will be operated through these two regulating rods now. It is also called as a regulating mechanism now. They are called as regulating shaft. Through these regulating shaft, I can move it this side so that it can be closed or it can be opened. The discharge to the runner can be controlled by means of this operation of this guide vanes. That is important now. Guide vanes are connected to regulating rings by means of link and lever now. By rotating the regulating shaft, the guide vanes can be closed or opened. That is important. It can be closed or opened so that the discharge to the runner can be controlled. So that is the importance. How it will work? We shall look it through one of the this one now. YouTube, you can see through this YouTube. I will open this YouTube and show it to you now. One minute. Yes, it is not operating. We will look into it. I will show you at the end of the show. I will look into it now. Not possible to operate now. You can see through this YouTube. Then anyhow, it is available. You can look into through this YouTube and you can understand how the guide vanes will operate now. Okay, I want to come out of this this one now. Back. Yes, it is operating. Just look into it now.
Let me tell you about this amazing offer from Udemy. Right now, they're having one of their biggest sales of the year, and their courses are up to 90% off.
Welcome to video tutorial of Mekanis Müller. I appreciate your continuing support and subscription to my channel. Water turbines are, in principle, very simple and efficient devices. But I always find pitch control of the Kaplan turbine blades, the spear rod control of the Pelton, and the wicket gate control of the Francis turbine very interesting. In this video, I am going to describe the working principle of the wicket gate linkage system. This might not be the 100% accurate descriptions, due to the fact that I never saw a Francis turbine, nor did I see wicket gates of this turbine up close. However, I believe it is close enough description for an engineering student, or a hobbyist to understand how the gates work. In my top view of a Francis turbine animation video, I described the wicket gates in very crude way. The wicket gates control the amount of water passing through the turbine. This in effect controls the power output of the turbine. If the power requirement in the grid is low, the wicket gates narrows the water passage and reduces the power output while preventing excessive water usage. On the other hand, if the demand for the electricity goes up, the gates are open, allowing more water pass through, thus increasing power output. As you can see here, each airfoil shaped wicket gates connected to a central disc with two linkages. The outer linkage and the wicket gate are connected such that any rotation of the outer linkage is transferred to the wicket gate without any slippage. However, the connections at both ends of the inner linkage acts like a hinge. The center disc, where the inner linkages are attached, has ability to make rotation around the turbine center point. The rotation of this disc is controlled by two pairs of hydraulic cylinders in such a way that, when one cylinder is pushing, the other is pulling. Assuming that the red color is denoting high pressure oil, and the blue one is the low, we can see this pushing and pulling action in the animation. Notice that how the color pair is shifting when the rotation direction of the center disc change. You should also notice the clever way this rotation of the center disc transferred with linkage pair to the wicket gates. Combined effect is that the simple push and pulls action of two hydraulic cylinders opens or closes all the wicket gates. I find this system very interesting and hope you enjoy it as much as I did.
Yes, I think you noticed how the working of the guide vanes will happen according to the requirement of water for the power generation, as well as how the operation happens by means of hydraulic shaft, regulating shaft. Okay, so now we shall go to the next part. Now the next part is the runner and runner blades. Now so here the runner and runner blades, as you can see here, now runner and runner blades are, it is a mixed flow turbine now, and the driving force on the runner is both due to impulse as well as reaction. Now okay, design of the runner blades decide how best, the design of the runner blade is very important, decides how well the turbine is going to perform. That is very, very important. Design of the runner blade itself is very much important now. So the here, as you can see here, here this also here now. So the runner blade is having the bucket shape at the bottom, as well as the water as it enters from the guide vanes into the runner. Now there will be a pressure difference that happens between the two runner plates, and the lift force is going to be developed, which is creating the reaction force now. And at the bottom, there will be impulse force is going to be developed, which is causing the rotation of the runner. Very important now. Okay, so runner blades is a mixed flow turbine, can be divided into two parts. This runner blade can be divided into two parts. This is first part, this is second part, what I am showing you here now. Okay, the upper part of the blade uses reaction force, that is the difference between the pressure between the two blades, that is the outside and the inside of the blade, creates the reaction and the lift, which makes a reaction force and the water flowing through it. And the lower half is in the shape of a small bucket using the impulse action of the water flowing through it. Now these two forces together responsible for the flow of the rotation of the runner. Now that means reaction as well as the impulse force, both the things are happening in the blade itself. Now as the water enters from the periphery, that is from the guide vane towards the runner, so as it flows here now, the top portion will be having the lift force is going to be developed, which is creating the change in the power. This is in the upper power, upper pressure, this will be in lower pressure, therefore a reaction force is going to be developed, a lift is going to be developed now. and bottom is having a bucket now, which creates the impulse force. So because of that, the rotation is going to take place now. That is very much important. That also I will show through a video now. Anyhow, these two are responsible for the rotation of the runner now. The runner is keyed to the shaft. That is, that you know it already. I have shown you already. The runner is keyed to the shaft. That means it is, as the runner rotates, the shaft will also rotate. That is very important. That you should know it now. Okay. So that means here you will be having this one. I will show you. This is runner is keyed to the shaft. Now this is the shaft now. Therefore, as the runner rotates, the shaft will also rotate. Okay. So runner is keyed to the shaft, which may be in vertical horizontal speed. That means it may be a horizontal shaft Pelton wheel turbine or a vertical shaft turbine. So according as it is keyed to the shaft. Generally, most of the Francis turbine are vertical shaft turbine now. So these are the runner blades, how the things are there. Here I have shown you the picture of the runner blade in detail now. So after the water enters through the draft, after the water passes through the runner, it finally enters into the draft tube. So all the energy, what is the purpose of draft tube? What is draft tube now? Draft tube is an enlarging tube now. As you can see here now, it is an enlarging tube now. The diameter here is less than the diameter here now. It is at the exit. This is the tail race. The water is entering into the tail race now. Here, all the energy what is there will not be converted. There will be certain part of kinetic energy, there will be certain part of all the, and certain part of pressure energy now. Pressure energy will be less, kinetic energy will be more now. However, this kinetic energy will be, should be completely utilized. The kinetic energy at the exit is to be completely utilized. What we will do now? By means of increasing the diameter of the draft tube, the velocity at this point, V2 will be less than V1. When V2 becomes less than V1, the pressure at this point, because it is the atmospheric pressure, that means this should come. The exit should be at vacuum pressure. That means the pressure should be as less as possible. That is going to help to increase the kinetic energy at the exit, which can be utilized further in the turbine now. That's what it is being told now. So here the draft tube is an integral part. Draft tube will be at the end of the runner. As at the exit of the runner, draft tube will be there. Any reaction turbine exit will be having the draft tube. The main function of draft tube is to reduce the water velocity from the exit of the runner towards the exit of the draft tube now. Okay. Draft tubes are conduits gradually increasing in cross section, connecting the runner exit to the tail race. It serves two purposes. One is decreases the pressure at the runner exit. That means when we decrease the pressure energy, what will happen? Velocity increase. So when pressure decreases, velocity increases. That you should know. That is our Bernoulli's principle now. So I want to decrease the pressure at the exit of the runner and to increase the velocity energy. By means of increasing the velocity energy, turbine can still work at a higher efficiency. Our aim is to see that turbine should work at higher efficiency because the head available itself is less. It is medium. It is not very high head. We are not unable to generate more energy because we are not having a large amount of head available in the reservoir. That is our criteria. We want to utilize the complete velocity, complete energy that is there in the water now. So this reaction, what we do now, we reduce the pressure energy at the exit of the runner and we will increase the velocity now. That is the important. at the exit of the runner, at the exit of the draft tube, it should be less than the atmospheric pressure. That's how the work should happen. And the draft tube, the water should not, because exit atmospheric pressure, less than atmospheric pressure means the water should not enter from tail race towards the runner also. That is another reason why we are using the draft tube now. So recovers the portion of the exit kinetic energy, recovers the portion of the exit kinetic energy. That is important. How much energy which is not being utilized by the runner is being utilized by providing the draft tube, which otherwise it will go as the waste now. That is important of the draft tube. We will look into it this YouTube also, then it will be easy for you to come to it now. Let's see whether we can look into it now. We are unable to open once again. There is some problem here now. I think we'll look into it now. Let us see. Can I go to the this one and show you?
Right now, Udemy is having one of their biggest sales of the year, and their courses are up to 90% off. If you don't know Udemy, they're an online...
Francis turbines are the most preferred hydraulic turbines. It contributes about 60% of the global hydropower capacity, mainly because it can work efficiently under a wide range of operating conditions. Most important part of Francis turbine is its runner. It is fitted with a collection of complex shaped blades. In runner, water is entered radially and leaves axially. During the course of flow, water glides over runner blades. Francis turbine blades are specially shaped. You can note that blades are having thin airfoil cross section. So when water flows over it, a low pressure will be produced on one side and high pressure on the other side. This will result in a lift force. You can also note one more peculiar thing about the blade. It is having a bucket kind of shape towards the outlet. So water will hit and produce an impulse force before leaving the runner. Both impulse force and lift force will make the runner rotate. So Francis turbine is not a pure reaction turbine. A portion of force comes from impulse action also. Thus, as water flows over runner blades, both its kinetic and pressure energy will come down. Since flow is entering radially and leaves axially, they are also called mixed flow turbine. Runner is connected to generator via a shaft for electricity production. This arrangement is fitted inside a spiral casing. Flow is entered via an inlet nozzle. flow rate of water will get reduced along length of casing, since water is drawn into the runner. But decreasing area of spiral casing will make sure that flow is entered to runner region almost at uniform velocity. Stay vanes and guide vanes are fitted at entrance of runner. The basic purpose of them is to convert one part of pressure energy to kinetic energy. Flow which is coming from the casing meets stay vanes, they are fixed. Stay vanes steers the flow towards the runner section, thus it reduces swirl of inlet flow. Demand for power may vary over time. The guide vane mechanism is used to control water flow rate and make sure that power production is synchronized with power demand. Apart from controlling flow rate, guide vanes also control flow angle to inlet portion of runner blade. Thus, guide vanes make sure that inlet flow angle is at optimum angle of attack for maximum power extraction from fluid. Low pressure at exit side of turbine may cause serious problems of cavitation. So a carefully designed draft tube is fitted at exit side to discharge the fluid out. Draft tube will transform velocity head to static head due to its increasing area and will reduce effect of cavitation. Hope you had a nice session on working of Francis turbines. Thank you.
So that's how the working principle of the Francis turbine is properly defined. Whatever we discussed till today, till now, is being informed in the video. It is a very good video. Once again, you can visit it now. Now, the next thing is working proportion of working proportion and design of the Francis turbine now. So this thing, you know it now, what is the net head, what is the gross head, this is the reaction turbine. So this is called as the tail race now, and this is called as the head race, this we discussed now. So net head is to be computed on the basis of the losses that is going to happen in the pelt and wheel. Now I am discussing here with reference to this point and this point only now. So what is the loss that is happening in the friction through pipe? So that is to be taken. So what is entering is called as the net head now. That we know it now. Okay, that is called as the net head now. So now the net head on the runner, is nothing but gross head, that is the difference in the water level between the head race and the tail race, and loss in the penstock, that is nothing but the net head, that we know it now. Okay, gross head minus of the loss of head in the penstock. Here there is no nozzle, what we see in the impulse turbine now. So that will become the net head now. So the net head available is also equal to the total energy available at the exit of the penstock, that means at this point. Total energy available at the exit of the penstock minus of the losses that is going to happen here now. What is the loss that is going to happen now? So the total energy available in the draft tube, that is what is the head available, what is the head available at this point minus of the head available at this point, will tell you what is the energy that is being utilized by the reaction turbine. Correct? Reaction turbine. So how much of energy that is available here, if you call this as E1, if you call this as E2, E1 minus of E2 is the net head available now. It is the net head available, H net now. So how do you find this one now? So we apply the Bernoulli's equation, that is P by W plus V squared by 2G plus Z of the penstock, and P by W plus V squared by 2G plus Z of draft tube now. So taking the draft tube at the datum now, if the draft tube exit is at the tail race level and datum is also at that level, then P by W plus Z will go up because it is the starting point where we are measuring now. It is the place where we are having. So here only we will be having Vd square by 2J, what is coming out, draft tube, what is the velocity with which it is coming out now. Vd, all the energy is being converted into Vd square by 2J, and that top one is as it is, we have utilized now. P1 by W plus V1 square by 2G plus Z now. So Vd square by 2G, where Vd is called at the velocity at the exit of the draft tube now. So if you neglect that Vd, that means let us assume that almost the velocity will become zero at the exit. We want to see that the energy is being completely utilized at the draft tube end, means Vd is equal to zero if we make. That means it is coming with zero velocity. It is not so, but we will assume like that now. Then we will get P by W plus V square by 2G plus Z is equal to V now. So that's how, that is nothing but the net head now. This is not V, this is nothing but the net head now. That is the net head now. Like that, we have to calculate it now. Now the work done. Work done by the runner, this we know it now. So this is the place where it is entering now. This is the place where it is entering, and this is the place it is coming out now. They are at different radiuses. Therefore, we will be having two velocity triangles, because in this there will be two velocity triangles. This is called the inlet velocity triangle, and this is called the outlet velocity triangle. So we already discussed in detail about the velocity triangles now in the previous impact of jet chapter is also to being dealt, as well as in the Pelton wheel. We have discussed about this now. V1 is called at the absolute velocity with which it is entering into the this one now, whereas U is the velocity with which the runner is rotating now. Then V1 minus of U1 will give you the VR1. V1 minus U1 will give you the VR1. What is U1? U1 is the velocity with which the runner is rotating. This is the U1 now. So V1 minus U1 will give you the V1 minus U1 will give you VR1, the relative velocity. The horizontal component of V1 is equal to VW1. The vertical component is VF1. VW1 is responsible for the rotation. Responsible for the rotation of the now. Very important. Velocity of wheel is very much important. This is VW1 now. Now coming to the outside now, so you will be knowing VR1. If there is no loss, shock loss is not there now, then this will become VR2. Otherwise, as we saw in the previous classes, VR2 will be around 0.85 times VR1, something like that you will get, 0.85 to 0.87 times, because of the losses that is going to happen when it passes through the runner, the shock loss and the friction loss here now. So you know the VR2 now, we know the VR2. V2 is called the absolute velocity of the jet outlet velocity, absolute velocity. Beta is the angle subtended between the absolute velocity with the horizontal now. And phi is the angle that is subtended by the VR2 with the horizontal now. U2 is the velocity of the runner at the outlet. VW2 is nothing but the horizontal component of the absolute velocity V2. Horizontal component of the absolute velocity V2. And VF2 is the vertical component of the absolute velocity V2 at the exit. This we have already discussed in the previous classes. Same thing we are going to go ahead now. So now, this I have explained here now. This is what I told now. So this is the inside now. This is the first thing now. So theta is called as the angle between theta is the angle between the absolute velocity, angle between the absolute velocity and the horizontal is called as alpha, and angle between the relative velocity and the horizontal is called as the theta. Now, alpha and beta are the angles subtended by the absolute velocity with reference to horizontal, whereas theta and phi are the angles subtended by the relative velocity with the horizontal. While we are drawing, the concept should be properly understood now. Okay. So now the work done, as you know it already, fx, what we were doing in the previous chapter on Pelton wheel, still it holds good now. Rho AV into VW1 plus VW2 into U. That is called as fx. Fx is equal to the work done is equal to fx is equal to rho a v1 into vw1 plus vw2 only, whereas the work done is equal to fx into u. Work done is equal to fx into u. So I will cancel out this. Sometime this will not work. Yes. So what is fx? What is force now? Mass into change in velocity. What is force now? Fx is equal to mass into change in velocity as per our impulse momentum theorem. Now mass is equal to rho av into vw1 is in which direction now? Just look into here now. Vw1 is in positive direction. It is in this direction. Vw1 is in this direction. And VW2, because V2 is in this direction now, V2 is in this direction. V2 is in this direction now. Because exit is in this direction, you just look into it now. So it will be having two component. One is this component and the one is this component now. So VW1 is in this direction, VW1. VW2 is in this direction. Therefore, minus of minus VW2 it will become. Therefore, what you will have now? Rho AV1 into VW1 plus VW2. When it happens now, which we already discussed now, when beta is acute. When beta is acute now. Beta is in acute now. You can see here now, beta is acute now. So fx, you know it now. Fx is equal to rho AV1 into VW1 plus of VW2. Beta is acute, otherwise it is negative. So in general, I can write it as plus or minus, according as if beta is less than 90 degree, it is positive. If beta is greater than 90 degree, it is negative. That is fx. So work done is equal to what? Work done is equal to fx into u, that is rho AV1 into VW1 plus or minus VW2 into u. So that's what we have written here now. VW2 concerned with u2 and VW1 is concerned with u1. Therefore, it will become rho AV. AV will become q. AV is nothing but Q that I have written now. So VW1 into U1 plus or minus VW2 into U2, because here it will not be same as we discussed in the Pelton wheel turbine. The velocity will be, the runner velocity U1 and U2 will be different, because R is great. The value of R is great tau. The difference of R is great tau. In the impulse turbine, it was hitting at the center, whereas here it is coming out, the velocity triangles are being at different radiuses, therefore you will be having different U1 and U2 now. Okay. So if at all, if beta becomes 90 degree, if beta becomes 90 degree means here this angle become 90 degree, that means this comes towards this now, VW2 will become 0. At that time, as we know, you will be having the highest efficiency. What we discussed in Francis turbine, Pelton mill turbine is true here also. At that time, you will be getting WQ by G. W by G is nothing but what? W by G is nothing but rho. Q is equal to A into V. W A V into VW1 and VW2. When VW2 will become 0, that means when exit is radial now, the maximum work done will be equal to this much now. Now, hydraulic efficiency, as usual, what we do it now, power developed by the shaft, the input power is nothing but the water power, WQH. Water power, input power is WQH, the water power. Output power is equal to what we have derived here, WQ by G into VW1 into U1. Now. That's what we have written. Otherwise, minus plus or minus you can write, no problem. Here plus or minus VW2 U2 can also be written. Okay, so that is general, but for maximum efficiency this is what we can do it now. However, as we have written here now, however, if the velocity of the whirlwind is not equal to 0, then VW1 plus or minus VW2 plus where when you have to use, minus when you have to use, that I told you. Plus when we have to use now, plus is to be used when beta is acute, minus is to be used when beta is obtuse. That's what that is still true now. So the mechanical efficiency is nothing but the shaft power divided by the power developed by the runner. This mechanical efficiency will come into picture because of the bearing and friction loss, which we are discussing from the torque of the turbine, friction loss, bearing and friction loss. Because of that, the mechanical efficiency will come. All the energy what is generated from the runner is being coming to the runner. If there is no loss, then mechanical efficiency is equal to overall efficiency. That should be known to you now. So our overall efficiency is nothing but hydraulic efficiency, what we discussed in the previous slide. This itself is the overall efficiency. Now it is hydraulic efficiency, it is coming out of the runner. If the mechanical efficiency is there, that means if there is some loss in the mechanical bearing and friction loss, then the power developed by the shaft is lesser than the power developed by the runner now. Shaft power developed by the power developed by the runner will give you the overall efficiency. Overall efficiency. So eta naught is equal to eta h into eta m. Generally this ranges between 80% and 90% what is being discussed already now. Now the working proportions of a Francis turbine, how the design is to be done now. That is important now. So the ratio of width to diameter, what is width? I have given you now, the width is here now. This is the width, B1 to the diameter. The ratio of width to the diameter is called as N now. It is called as N. Generally, it ranges between 0.10 to 0.45. The ratio of width B1 to the diameter D1 at the inlet. This is the inlet now. Okay. This is the outlet now. B1 and D1 is called as the, it is called as the N. That is called as the N now. The flow ratio, as usual, what we discussed in the previous this one, Kf into root 2 gh, Cv into root 2 gh we were calling, here Kf into root 2 gh we will call now. So V is equal to Cv into root 2 gh, what we were using in the impulse turbine, where Cv is the nozzle loss, it is there now, but here there will be certain loss when it is flowing from in the runner, therefore it is called as the Kf. Kf varies from 0.15 to, that is 15% to 30%, there will be loss when it flows through the runner now. Okay. So Vf is equal to Kf into root 2 GH, or Kf is equal to Vf1 by root 2 GH. Now the speed ratio we have already utilized in the same in the impulse turbine, that we are calling it as Ku into root 2 GH. Same thing is hold here, where H is called as the net rate. This is called as the speed ratio. It is the ratio of the velocity of the wheel to the velocity of the through the penstock. This is nothing but 2gh is nothing but the velocity through the penstock only. That is the net head now. Okay. Now the design of Francis turbine depends upon the various parameters: how the power is to be generated, what is the speed, what is the head available. All these things fixes the design of the Pelton wheel turbine now. So while we are designing it, we have to decide suitable eta naught, eta h, that is the efficiency, what should be the hydraulic efficiency, what should be the mechanical efficiency, what should be the overall efficiency, what is Kf, the flow velocity, and what is Ku. These things ought to be suitably assumed and determine the value of Q now by using this formula. You know the value of P to be generated, how much power is to be generated, and you know the value of W, and you know the head availability, and efficiency is assumed, therefore you can get the value of Q now. Okay. So now, when once you know this one, you calculate the area of the runner. So what is the area of the runner now? You can see here now, pi d1. Pi d1 is the diameter now. Pi d1 is the diameter now. Minus of z t1. What is the t1 now? T1 is the thickness of the blades now, that is the area with which it is moving, that is the area with which it is flowing now. Therefore, this is the area which is flowing. Pi d1 minus of z t1 into b1, that will give you the area, that area of this one now. So where z is the number of blades that are there, generally it is 16 to 24 blades will be there now. Okay, so this is the way that we are going to design now. So here it is equal to KT1 into Pi D1 into B1. What is KT1? KT1 is called as the vane thickness factor. Vane thickness factor now. Vane thickness factor now. Pi D1 is there now. Pi D1 is the total area. Total area here, Pi D1, that is the area with which it is flowing, into B1. Into B1, so that is the area with which it is, total area that is flowing now, that is the development what I have done. It is the development, you just see it now. Here I have developed here now, total developed, that is the area into through which it is flowing into B1, that will give you the total area with which the area of the outer periphery, total area of the outer periphery, or at the runner inlet, that is at the runner inlet. Therefore KT1 is called as the thickness factor now. Thickness factor. This will be, this you can assume now. This you can, this will be given in the problem, but it will be assumed in the design now. Generally, it is ranges between 0.94 to 0.95 now. When once you know this one, you can calculate the value of Q now. You can calculate the value of Q because you know the value of VF1. VF1 is already being calculated. Vf1 is equal to Kf into root 2 GH. Kf into root 2 GH, that you know it now. When once Vf1 is known to you, you can obtain the value of Q. You know the value of D1, you know the value of B1, you can calculate the value of KT1, so you can get the value of Q now. Therefore, you can obtain the value of velocity with the flow should happen by means of using this formula. You can get the discharge, or directly you can utilize that. Both the equations we will use it. Vf1 is equal to Q divided by KT1, that is the thickness factor, pi D1 into B1 now. Okay. So if B1 is equal to N1 into D1, that we have already discussed in the first this one now. B1 is equal to N into D1 now. B1 is equal to N into D1. So that is called as the ratio of width to diameter. Ratio of width to diameter. So I substitute that one. I substitute that one and I will get the value of the VF1 now. VF1, as I've already told you, this is also equal to KF into root 2 GH. KF into root 2 GH is equal to this one now. So you can get the value of D1. What should be the diameter? Like that, you can obtain the value of D. When once D is obtained, you can obtain the value of B now. What is B now? B is equal to pi into D1 now. B is equal to pi into D1 can be obtained now. Okay. So like that, we will obtain the breadth and the depth of the diameter of the runner now. So when once you know this one now, the peripheral velocity, as you know, this is the u is equal to pi d1 n divided by 60. You can obtain the value of u1 as well as u2 can also be obtained now. The eta h can be obtained by using formula vw1 u1 by gh. That you know it already now. Vw1 is equal to eta h into gh divided by u1. This you can obtain because eta h is known to you now. Eta h is assumed. Therefore, you know the value of h. You have already obtained the value of u1. You can get the value of velocity of wheel in the beginning. When once vw1 is obtained, you can obtain the vw2 as well as you can obtain the efficiency also now. To obtain the guide vane angle now, use this velocity triangle. I will get tan alpha. Tan alpha is equal to Vf1 divided by Vw1. This is the inlet velocity triangle. Tan alpha is equal to Vf1 by Vw1. Tan theta is equal to Vf1 divided by Vw1 minus of u1. That is from the inlet velocity triangle now. Okay. The runner diameter d2, that is at the exit. This is the thing, this d2. Generally, it will be 50% of the runner diameter at the inlet now. Generally, it is equal to 50% of the runner diameter at the inlet now. When once that is obtained, you can obtain the value of u1 is equal to pi d1 n by n. Pi d1 n by 60, that you know it now. So u2, because d1 is d2 is divided by 2 is there, n is constant, pi is constant, 60 is constant, u2 will be equal to u1 by 2. When d2 is equal to d1 by 2, u2 will be equal to u1 by 2 now. Okay. So the velocity of flow at the exit can be obtained. You know this formula, q is equal to k into pi dB Vf1, which we derived now. Here u is equal to k into, what is k now? Kt is nothing but the thickness constant. Kt is equal to thickness constant. That we have assumed it equal to 0.95. Generally it is 0.94 to 0.95. That is being shown now. So when once that is there, because it is a continuity equation, Kt1 into pi dB1, pi d1b1 into Vf1 should be equal to Kt2 into pi d2 b2 into Vf2 from continuity equation now. So therefore you will get Vf1 to Vf2 ratio. You can get the value of the various factor. Usually Vf1 will be equal to Vf2 now. Kt1 will be equal to Kt2. B2 will be equal to 2 times B1. D2 will be equal to D1 by 2. That we have already told you now. Therefore, what is B2 now? B2 is the thickness at the beginning. This is what we have shown you now. This is B2 at this point. Okay. So, therefore, you can very well obtain the equation, for Vf1 and Vf2 now. These are the parameters now. So runner vane angle at the exit, once again we will find by means of this equation. Runner vane angle at the exit, phi, just look into it, tan phi is equal to Vf2 divided by u2 plus Vw2. Vf2 divided by U2, if at all, if beta is 90. If beta is 90, Vf2 by U2 only, because we are having this will not be there now. Vw2 will not be there if it is radial flow. Otherwise, we have to say tan phi is equal to Vf2 divided by U2 plus Vw2 can be utilized. The number of vanes, as I have already told you, number of vanes will be equal to 16 to 24. What is this 16 to 24 now? So this one, number of vanes here, this will be 16 to 24 will be there now. That is what we have to understand now. So these are the design parameters. These are the design parameters. One is N, ratio of bucket width to the bucket depth at the entrance, okay, B1 by D1 now. And flow ratio is equal to Vf1 is equal to Kf into root 2 GH. U is equal to Ku into root 2 GH as it is now. And eta naught is equal to P by WQH, that you know it already now. The same equation is being utilized now. Eta naught is equal to P divided by WQH. What is this? This we are using in the Pelton wheel turbine also, shaft power divided by water power, P divided by WQH. From that equation we have written now. And how you found the area of the runner? So I have developed this. I have developed this. Developed means what? I cut open this and I have found. This is the cut open, this one. Now this is the, this we will get is a KT into pi D1 into B1 now, where Z is the number of runner vanes, runner blades that are there now. 16 to 24, I have told you. This will be equal to 16 to 24 into thickness. What is the thickness of? That is the loss that is going to happen, because this is the flow area. The flow area is this one now. That flow area is being calculated. So pi D is the total area over which I have kept. This is, I have extended this one. I have developed, this is pi D. Pi D, that is the length. This is the length. Over this, I have put the runner vanes. So these are the disturbances that are happening now. The runner vanes. These thicknesses ought to be deducted. These thicknesses ought to be deducted. When I deduct these thicknesses, actual area through which it is flowing will be coming. That's what KT1 will come into picture. ZT1, pi D1, minus of ZT1. Z is number of vanes. So 16 vanes means 16 into thickness will be there now. That is the loss that is going to happen now. That area is not available for the runner to, the water to flow into B1. Into B1 means this is the B1. Okay. That will give you the total area of outer periphery. Total area of outer periphery. Okay. At the runner inlet. That is at runner inlet now. Okay. So now, this will be taken, and I have calculated the value of Vf1 now. And I have calculated the value of D1 now. I calculated the value of D1. And P is equal to pi into D1. You can calculate it now. And the U1 is equal to pi D1 N by N. And eta H is equal to Vw1 U by GH. That you know it already now. Okay. Vw1 is equal to, you can calculate the velocity of the wavelet inlet now. So you calculated the, you solved the inlet triangle and obtained the guide vane angle and runner blade angle now. Guide vane angle is this one, alpha. Runner vane angle is theta. Alpha is guide blade angle with which it is hitting now. Blade angle, and theta is runner blade angle. So what is this lunar blade angle? So if I draw a tangent here, it will be here theta and phi, alpha and beta now. So these two are the tangents to the wave. These are tangent to the lunar blade now. This is theta now. This will be theta now. That we have already discussed in the impulse impact of jet chart also now. Okay. Tan alpha and tan beta, tan alpha and theta can be obtained by means of solving the inlet triangle. Tan phi and tan beta can be obtained by means of outlet triangle now. If beta becomes radial now, this V2 will become coincided with this, Vf2 will become Vw2 will become 0 and Vf2 will be equal to V2 now. So with that we have obtained the value of various factor. D2 is equal to D1 by 2. What is D2? Outside. This is D2 is equal to D1 by 2 now. U2 is equal to U1 by 2 because we use this equation now. And Vf1 by Vf2, we will get the velocity of flow and velocity of V2. The velocity of flow at the exit Vf2 can be obtained using this formula by means of continuity equation you can obtain. So generally Vf1 is equal to Vf2 and Kf1, Kt1 is equal to thickness will not change. The velocity of flow will not change now. That gives B2 will be equal to 2 times B1. That is important. When once you that use that one, B2 will be equal to 2 times B1. What is B2? Just look into here now. B2 is the thickness at this point. B2 will be equal to 2 times this one. Okay. And D2 will be equal to D1 by 2. Okay. These things will be utilized for solving the problem now. How to design the problem, we will look into it now. And this phi is being lunar vane angle at the exit can be obtained by using formula Vf2 by U2 provided if beta is 90 degree. Otherwise what will happen now? Tan phi is equal to Vf2 divided by U2 plus Vw2. What is the triangle is showing? U2 plus Vw2, tan phi is equal to U2 Vf2 divided by U2 plus Vw2 is to be obtained. So how to solve? Let us see it in the next classes. So last one, what we are told is number of vanes generally varies from 16 to 24 now. How to solve the numericals? We shall see it in the next class. Thank you.